もう少しだけ、もう少しだけ踏み出せたのなら、そう小さな優しさを分け合えたのなら、ありふれた一日が素敵な日になってゆく。ほら、そうやって何度でも喜びは巡る。私の優しさに変わったんだ。ほら、喜びは巡る。もう少しだけ、もう少しだけ踏み出せたことが、もう少しだけ、ほんの少しだけ優しくなれたことが、ありふれた一日を特別な一日に、ほら、変えてくれたんだ。きっと今日もあなたから私へと
違う暮らしの形、守
沈むように溶けてゆくように信じれないことそんなのどうしたってきっとこれからだっていくつもあってそのたんび怒って泣いてくるそれでもきっといつかはきっと僕らはきっと分かり合えるさ信じてるよた僕の手を振り払う君もう嫌だって疲れた
Okay, good afternoon. So today we will continue from the last time, and I think today I will try to finish the lecture so that you will have free time on Sunday, and nobody would be worried about. So I will try to maybe some section of the lecture I will pass quickly, and I will focus on only some section that would be more difficult to understand. Yeah, but other section, if I consider it's not difficult, yeah, maybe you can have a look at the slide and can learn by yourself. Yeah, so now we have two materials left to talk about, nanopolymer and nanobiomaterials. For the nanobiopolymer, we will discuss about the so-called conductive polymer. Conductive polymer is a kind of polymer, a kind of plastic that can conduct electron or conduct electricity. And the discovery of the conductive polymer lead to the Nobel Prize in chemistry in 2000. I have already mentioned in the introduction to nanotechnology that the professor from Japan, Hideki Shirakawa, he discovered this. And what is the common feature of the conductive polymer? Conductive polymer have a conduction channel formed by the interconnected conjugation double bond. You can see here, this is a double bond, double bond, double bond. You see it, the formation of this double bond, it will have the alternating double bond, alternating with the single bond. You see, this is double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond. And this kind of alternation we call is the conjugation. So for with this, for any polymer with have formation like this, will be conductive polymer. And after this discovery of this polymer, this one is originally discovered in 1980 something. And it is called polyacetylene. After the discovery, and after they published this in journal, Nature magazine, Nature journal, a lot of people follow them. A lot of people around the world conduct research around this type of polymer and synthesize several types of polymer. And if you look here, this is the example of some notable conductive polymer that have been discovered later. This, you see, this is one, the top one, polyacetylene. This is the original conductive polymer discovered by the Nobel Prize. And after that, a lot of people discover or synthesize other polymer. But if you look carefully, you will see that all of these polymer have the same feature. It has alternation of double bond. It's had double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, like this. This alternation makes this kind of polymer the conductive polymer. And actually, the polymer is like a spaghetti in the dish. If you order spaghetti, you will see that single strand of the spaghetti. This is the kind of polymer, but when it mixed together, it has some disorder. So in single chain of polymer, electron can travel to from the head to the tail. But if it cannot travel, it will jump like this. If the electron want to go to here, you see that it cannot go by a single chain of conductive polymer, so it has to jump. And by jumping, electron lose some kind of energy. So that's why this conductive polymer is not as conductive as metal. Metal conduct electron better than polymer. Yeah. So conductive polymer is not conducting material, but it is a kind of semi-conducting or semi-conducting material. Yeah. It's not conductive material like metal. Yeah. It is a kind of semiconductor. Yeah. So it conducts electron much poorer than the metal. Yeah. And for this property, yeah, the polymer has not only the electronic property, but it also have optical property. Yeah. You can the very first application of conductive polymer is to make a so-called light emitting device. Yeah. So this is what I my research 15 years ago. Yeah. I already stopped this research. Yeah. I did not do this research nowadays. Yeah. I have done research in other field already, but I just want to show you that what I used to do. Yeah. 15 years ago. Yeah. I fabricate a device from conductive polymer. Yeah. You see, the advantage of the conductive polymer is that you can make electronic device based on solution chemistry, yeah, based on wet chemistry. Yeah. Normally in semiconductor, in the modern semiconductor, you cannot make semiconductor device in wet lab. Yeah. You have to do it in very clean environment. Yeah. But the advantage of conductive polymer is that you can use dirty chemistry to make an electronic device. And this is example because the conductive polymer can be dissolved in many kinds of solution. You can make thin film by spin coating. When you fabricate on the device, yeah, you can make this device illuminating. Yeah. And at the time, I have test many type of polymer to make yellow color, blue color, green color, red color. Yeah, it depends on the structure of the polymer itself. For example, here, this is the red color polymer. Yeah, if you look at the structure, yeah, this is a kind of polyphenyl vinylene. Yeah, so it had a phenyl group here and vinyl group here. Yeah. So, and it give a red color. Yeah, but this one, this is a polyfluorine. Yeah, it's make blue color, and this one is make green color. So I have made the red and green and blue color. Yeah. So, as I have already mentioned in the previous lecture, that once you make matter color, yeah, red, green, blue, you can make a display. Yeah. And this sometimes people call this the conductive polymer light emitting device. Sometimes people call OLED. Yeah. And maybe some of you already own smartphone that use this OLED. Yeah. Organic light emitting device. Yeah. So because of the discovery of the conductive polymer, yeah, it makes the field called organic electronics booming. Yeah. The advantage of organic electronics is that you see for the display, the monitor, yeah, you can make it thinner and thinner. And nowadays, you already have seen some kind of device very thin and flexible. Yeah. So the organic electronic create opportunity and possibility to make electronic flexible. Yeah. So it originate another technology branch called flexible electronics. So here you can see that we can have flexible solar cell, yeah, made from conductive polymer, yeah, coated on plastic. Yeah, we can have a foldable smartphone. Yeah, we have flexible battery. Yeah, we have for example electronic skin, yeah, that I maybe I have mentioned, yeah, I used to mention about this, yeah, electronic skin, yeah, that you can make flexible, you can make sensor, flexible sensor, and you can attach this plastic, yeah, on your skin, yeah, to make sensor to measure for example heart rate, yeah. And because the conductive polymer is soluble, yeah, it can be, you can use solvent, yeah, to dissolve conductive polymer. So the what is the implication? Yeah, the implication is that if you can dissolve the polymer by a solution, you can make an ink. So if you can have an ink, it can become conductive ink. You can, with this, you can print the ink on various substrate like paper, plastic, textile, even rubber. Yeah? You see here, you can use the conventional printing process. Yeah, normally the printing process, they use the printing process for printing newspaper, for printing books, for printing magazine. Yeah, but that kind of ink is the stupid ink. Yeah, it's just make color. Yeah, but here in this case, you can print. You can print the conductive ink to make your substrate more smart. Yeah, you see, ancient printing or old printing, it print only the letter. Yeah, but nowadays, yeah, you can print logical circuit. You can print electronic circuit. Yeah, that can compute, that can think, that can calculate. Yeah, you see, printed electronic makes the printing smart. Yeah, make the paper smarter. Yeah, make the plastic, yeah, smarter. So that's why I think the discovery of conductive polymer is very, very important. So I would like to show you the video, yeah, some video that can have and make you inspiring, yeah.
Today, operating as a wholly owned Xerox subsidiary, Park is using the core competencies developed from its original mandate to invent the office of the future to create novel solutions for other industries in transition.
Oh, yeah.
One current focus area for Park is applying its deep knowledge of printing processes to the emerging technology of printed electronics.
Printing the circuit
for the past 10 years, Park has been pioneering this field from material science.
And now, yeah, you can see that this is the law, yeah, of plastic, and this is the printer. Yeah. And when the low plastic pass the printer put the ink, the conductive polymer onto the substrate to make a circuit.
The way to application development. Printed electronics starts with the notion that advanced materials can be treated like an ink. And these inks, organic or inorganic or nanomaterials, can be printed to create circuits, sensors, memory, or even batteries. The range of functional...
They mentioned that this printer can create the electronic circuit, the memory, for example, memory, or even the sensor or solar cell. Yeah.
Inks that can be engineered through material science and chemistry is potentially infinite.
Yeah.
In addition,
yeah, see,
we have been partnering
plastic,
with commercial entities, governments, and universities to build an industry-wide ecosystem across the entire value chain, from functional inks to pioneering applications.
Printed electronics is...
Okay, yeah. That's a brief example. Yeah. And because of this advancement, then now the lighting become flexible. Yeah, you see here, this is a flexible lighting. Normally the lamp is a round object, yeah, but here you can make a lamp flexible and you can make any shape. Yeah, here this is a different type of the lamp that you can make. Yeah, you can make the lamp on maybe desktop, yeah, or you can make it on the wall, yeah, to make a wall or to make it a curtain and so on. Yeah, this is a really interesting. Yeah, and then the next application I would like to mention is about the electrochromic polymer. Yeah, so electrochromic has not only electrical property, but it has the optical property. Yeah, electro means electron. Yeah, chromic means the color. Electrochromic polymer means the polymer that can change color. Yeah, the polymer that can change color due to the electron movement in the material. So when you pass, for example, here, when it is the inactive, yeah, the polymer here is does not allow the light to pass. Yeah. But after you pass electricity into this polymer, then this polymer become immediately, yeah, active, and it allow the light to pass. Yeah. So here you can use this film of polymer. You can put on the window of the car so that you see now if you use this film on the car, you can change by choice. Yeah. When you want to be in the dark, or when you want to allow the light to pass and to see the view outside, yeah, you can select it. Yeah. Nowadays, the film that put on the car is inactive. Yeah. So sometimes, for example, in Thailand is a hot country, yeah, and the sunlight is very strong. So most people they use dark film, yeah. And in the daytime it's okay, yeah. But in the nighttime, when outside is dark, yeah, it's difficult for the people in the car, yeah, to see the outside, yeah, and it's not quite safe, yeah, to have such a film. Yeah, but in the future you can select what you want. Yeah, so electrochromic polymer is like this. Yeah, yeah. Here you see this girl, she's working and the sunlight impact her, so she can turn the window to be to screen the light coming. Yeah, here. Yeah, you with electrochromic polymer, you can turn off the light, yeah, so that the light cannot pass through this window. Yeah. So another type of polymer, yeah, another type of nanopolymer is photochromic polymer. Yeah. So the photochromic polymer is similar to electrochromic polymer. Yeah. Photo means the light of photon. Yeah. Chromic means the color. So this polymer change color depending on selecting receiving energy from photon. Yeah. So it means if this polymer receive outside photon, it will change color. Yeah. So the application is to make a sunscreen, yeah, sunglass. Yeah. For example, here, if you use this type of the glass, yeah, you can order, yeah, from Amazon, and even in Thailand you can have this type of sunglass. Yeah, so this is UV 400 protection. Yeah, so here you see if normal, yeah, in normal light, maybe in your house, yeah, when it is not so bright, yeah, the sunglass allow the pass through light a lot. Yeah. But as soon as sunlight turn to be brighter, your sunglass will be darker. So here, yeah, in the sunlight, in the bright sunlight, the sunglass become dark. Yeah. But in the cloudy environment, yeah, maybe under the rain, yeah, your sunglass will become more transparent. Yeah. So the mechanism, how about the mechanism? The mechanism is like this. Yeah. It, the photochromic effect of this polymer is based on the structure transformation between the two isomer, the Z isomer and C isomer. Here, if you look at the spectrum, when it has very bright sunlight, it has a lot of UV, and blue color. So this one will absorb this spectrum and turn into the yellow structure, the C structure. And with this structure, the spectrum of absorbent will change. And with this, it absorb many spectrum of the light. So the sun gas will become darker. But without, for example, when the sunlight is dimming, there is no such energy to make the ring close, to make the ring closure. So the ring will open and come back to the original structure again. And in that case, your sun gas will not absorb light anymore. Your sun gas will absorb light at different wavelengths and allow more light to pass through. Then your sun gas will become more transparent. You can look at outside and then you can see which the environment will be better to be visible for you. So this is the advantage of the photochromic polymer. You don't need to feed energy. In electrochromic polymer, you have to feed energy. But in this case, you don't have to do that. So, and here, this is another application of the lab on the chip. It's a kind of a conductive polymer used on lab on chip. You can make the whole laboratory. You can miniaturize the whole laboratory, shrink it down to make on laboratory activity onto only one chip. On this chip, for example, when you use one drop of blood, it can analyze. It has a pump. It has a kind of incubator inside this chip. On this chip, it has some chromatography and so on. You can analyze it using mobile phone or mobile device. So this lab on chip is I have heard about it already about 20 years, but today it's still at the research. I have not seen much of the commercial one in the market. But I think maybe in the next 5 years, it will be more in the market. I think you have experience with the ATK to test your COVID. This is a simple version of the lab on chip. It's a simple test kit. You see that if you buy it, now the prices are around 50 baht, the cheapest one, but the more expensive one is around 200 baht or 100 baht. So why that on chip that like this that is not available in the market? Because of the price. You see, ATK is the most simple one. The price already expensive. If you use this one, maybe the price more than 1,000 baht, and perhaps if it come to Thailand, maybe it's even even more expensive. That's why it's still not available in the market. Because if it's too expensive, then it's not possible in the market. So here I finished the nanopolymer, and then I would like to start to talk about the nanobiomaterial. And in this lecture, we will mention about DNA. Polypeptide is a protein. We will talk about the lipid, and we will talk about the carbohydrate. These are on biomaterials, and maybe some of you are belonging to some lab that are already working on this type of nano materials. So, what is the importance of the biomaterial? The importance of biomaterial is that many biomaterial that have already nanotechnology by nature. So every life, every living organism, ourselves, human, as a human, dog, bacteria, small and big animal, they are already have biomaterial and they have nanotechnology inside. So even the smallest stuff that similar to living organism like virus. Virus is not life. Virus is not living organism. For us, virus is a kind of nanomachine trying to copy itself as much as possible. So by definition, you know that bacteria is alive. But virus is not. Virus is a kind of machine. And it is a nanomachine. If you disintegrate the virus in water, later virus can reassemble to again to make itself it will suck on a component together and make itself again. So you cannot kill virus easily. If you kill virus, you for example, if you shed it by half, but if it's still in the water, it can come back, resemble again as a virus. So that's why it's difficult to kill virus. That's why in many cases, the virus is still a very population disease that have problem for us. So, okay, not only virus, but even smaller than this, you can find the biomachine or nanomachine. And the notable, one noteworthy biomachine to talk about is called ATP synthase. ATP is a type of molecule, energetic molecule, that is a fundamental of our life. You eat carbohydrate, you eat sugar, but you don't burn sugar for your energy directly. You have to translate sugar into ATP. So ATP is the basic, the most basic energy molecule that we use to think, to talk, to move ourselves. We use ATP. And ATP synthase is a kind of machine that reproduce ATP. Because when you use the energy, ATP will be changed to be ADP. Adenosine diphosphate. And this machine, ATP synthase, will pump phosphorus phosphate into ADP to make ATP again, so that you can use ATP later. So this is a very amazing biomachine that it make it move. It is like living thing. It can do itself. It can work by its own. So that's why scientists like to study this very much. There is even some research group, they just study about the ATP synthase. So would like to show you the video for this bio machine. This is editing.
It's been called one of the wonders of the molecular world, an amazing nanoscale machine. ATP synthase is a high-tech micromolecular power generator inside the cells of your body. It generates adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, an energy molecule that provides fuel that every one of your cells needs to function. Without this fuel, your cells will cease operation, and so will you. ATP synthase works like a rotary engine. The barrel-shaped rotator is composed of 10 to 15 protein parts called subunits. The rotator spins around, transmitting mechanical energy into the drive shaft of the machine, which helps make ATP. This drive shaft has a specially placed bump that opens and closes parts as the drive shaft spins around. This bump opens special
protein. ATP come and phosphate come and then it's packed together to make the ATP.
Protein subunits on the bottom of the machine. When the bottom subunits open, a spent energy molecule called adenosine diphosphate, or ADP, enters the machine. The mechanical motion causes the ADP to bind with an additional phosphate group, creating the ATP energy molecule. And the ATP drifts off into the cell, ready to power some biomechanical reaction. The ATP synthase machine has many parts we recognize from human-designed technology. A rotor, a stator, a drive shaft, and other basic components of a rotary engine. The ATP synthase is one of thousands of elegantly designed molecular machines inside your cells that make your life and all known life possible. ATP synthase. An example of intelligent design.
Yeah, they even place this type of molecule that is very intelligent to be designed. Yeah. That's why sometimes we look at the nature and try to copy from the nature to make our technology. Yeah. So here we talk about the DNA. All of you, I think, have knowledge on this. The specialty of DNA is that it has the molecular recognition. In the DNA, we have four types of the base: adenine, A, T, G, C, and A would like to pair with T. You will see it recognize each other because it has two hydrogen bond. Here, guanine and cytosine is recognized by each other by having three hydrogen bond. So A and C will never match, will never pair each other. G and T will never pair each other. A and G will never pair. Yeah. So only A and T, G and C. So based on this, you can make so-called DNA nanotechnology. You can design DNA. Yeah? You can design DNA, A, T, C, G, and so on, so that it can match the counterpart, it can match each other. So that, for example, when you have the molecule number one, you have molecule number two, this only this direction you can have the shape. Yeah. For example, if you have number two palm, the green one here, this direction cannot match with this direction. You can do it only in this direction. Yeah. So if you have a lot of one palm, two palm, for example, you have 1,000, yeah, you put it in a beaker. Finally, it will form a structure like this. Yeah. It will form by itself. We call it cell assembly. Yeah. So by using this advantage, yeah, the molecular recognition mechanism like this, you can design various DNA structure. Here, this is an example. You see, here, this various structure, it was constructed by itself. Yeah. You just design a piece of DNA, and then you throw it in the solution. Yeah. Finally, it will create itself to make complicated structure like this. Yeah. So that is amazing. Yeah. So you can have, for example, here you can make the cube structure. Yeah. You can make the cross structure. Yeah. The ball that look like football. Yeah. Here you see, if you have this piece three times, if you have this piece three times, and this piece one time, you will create this. Yeah. And then this one can, if you have many of this one, it can, you can create this structure, and even this structure. Yeah. And for this structure, you need this type of molecule. Yeah. So that when you have this type of molecule, it can create automatically, yeah, to create this structure. So with this design, you can design not only the one the zero dimension structure, you can create one dimension structure like the tube, yeah, or the fiber. Yeah. You see here, this is a tube, yeah, 20 helix tube, yeah. And you can create 3D structure like this. Yeah. You may have question. What is the purpose to construct structure like this? Yeah. Normally, scientists want to create this structure in order to put drug molecule inside this. Yeah. So that this one will deliver the drug to the target. Yeah. So this field is called the drug delivery or drug targeted delivery. Because the DNA is biocompatible materials. So if you put the drug inside it, it will take the drug. It will not raise the immunity or the immune system to fight against it. Yeah. Because DNA is biocompatible material. Yeah. It can travel anywhere in your body. And if you decide the DNA to for specific organ in your body. For example, you may design the DNA to recognize the heart or the liver inside your body so that it can transport this drug into the target with high precision. Yeah, yeah, this is an example. A lot of people working on DNA, yeah, because it is based on your imagination. You can create different type of DNA structure. Even you can make a world map. Yeah, you can make a world map. Yeah. For example, here, DNA assemble together to create the world map. Yeah, you can even use the software. Yeah, I will show the video later. Yeah, you can use the software design. You can ask the software that, okay, I want to make a box. Please design DNA for me. Then the software will tell you, okay, you must have this kind of molecule. You must have this type of molecule and so on. Yeah. And nowadays, you can send the DNA formula to some company, and company will synthesize the DNA for you. Yeah. It's not expensive nowadays. Yeah. You can even design your own DNA molecule. Yeah. There are a lot of company online. Yeah. You can order it. Yeah. And here, what are they doing with this? Yeah. They design a box that you can keep something here, maybe the drug molecule or some nutrient, and then you can put the key. You can program it. Okay, don't open until you find the target. Yeah. So the DNA here, finally the DNA here, it will try to find the target and then release the capturing molecule. Yeah. So if it find the key, it open. So let's see some video. Yeah.
A recent development in nanotechnology allows scientists to build nanostructures using DNA bricks. These bricks work a lot like interlocking Lego pieces. Each of these new bricks is made up of a single strand of DNA, and each strand is 42 nucleotides long. You can think of the strand as a Lego-like brick that has two pins and two holes. The pin of one brick is able to plug into the hole of another brick, but only if the DNA sequences of the two strands that make up the pin and the hole are complementary. The blocks self-assemble, connecting only in areas where the DNA sequences complement each other. The two-dimensional structure can consist of any
piece on other piece being assembled together by its own.
Yeah. Any number of DNA bricks, but each has a unique DNA sequence and each has a specific location within the structure. To build a certain structure, all we have to do is withhold specific bricks before we allow them to self-assemble. Using this process, we've built over 100 two-dimensional shapes, including these. But our goal is to create three-dimensional shapes. To do this, we need to make an adjustment to some of the bricks. In effect, we rotate by 90 degrees how any two bricks connect
one to desire three dimension
to each other. It's the helical nature of DNA that allows us to do this. All we need to do is to shorten the DNA strands from 42 bases to 32. This allows us to build in three dimensions. As with the two-dimensional structures, each brick within our block structure has a unique DNA sequence and fits in only one location within the cube. You can think of the cube as a three-dimensional canvas consisting of 1,000 voxels. Each voxel is defined by 8 base pairs of DNA and measures about 2.5 nanometers. To make a certain shape, we withhold bricks before we allow them to self-assemble. We've built over 100 different three-dimensional shapes in the lab from our 1,000 voxel canvas. Here is a computer-generated view of some of these shapes.
This is a design.
And here are microscopic images of the actual shapes as seen from above.
It's from the AFM, you see. Yeah, so this is a proof of the existence of this type of DNA structure.
We believe that the ability to construct 3D structures will extend the range of applications that DNA nanotechnology can address, including making sophisticated DNA devices to mimic biosynthetic machineries and to arrange guest molecules in 3D space to generate a variety of functional nanomaterials. In addition, this technology may prove crucial for a variety of applications, such as drug delivery and therapeutic applications.
They mentioned that mainly they want to use it for drug delivery. Yeah. Then another video that make you more understanding of this possibility. Yeah.
Deoxyribonucleic acid, more commonly known as DNA, is a molecule that encodes the genetic instructions used in the development and functioning of all known living organisms and many viruses. Most DNA molecules consist of two biopolymer strands coiled around each other to form a double helix. Because DNA is so stable and can easily be programmed by changing its sequence, many scientists see it as a desirable building material for nanoscale structures. In the past, using a strategy called DNA origami, scientists were able to construct two-dimensional structures from DNA and later three-dimensional structures. But now, MIT biological engineers have created a new computer model that allows them to design the most complex three-dimensional DNA shapes ever produced. The new approach...
Before you decide it, you can decide by computer and allow, ask the computer to predict what it looks like after if you synthesize it.
Relies on virtually cutting apart sequences of DNA into components called multi-way junctions, which are the fundamental building blocks of DNA structures. These junctions, which form naturally during DNA replication, consist of two parallel DNA helices in which the strands unwind and cross over the binding strand to a strand of the adjacent DNA helix. After virtually cutting the DNA into smaller sections, the new computer program reassembles them into larger structures, such as rings, disks, and other shapes. By changing the sequences of these DNA components, designers can also easily create arbitrarily complex architectures, including symmetric cages such as tetrahedrons, octahedrons, and dodecahedrons. This new design program could allow researchers to build DNA scaffolds to anchor arrays of proteins that mimic the photosynthetic proteins found in plant cells, or create new delivery vehicles for drugs or RNA therapies. The researchers also hope to create a version of the model that allows the designer to specify a shape and obtain the sequence that will produce that shape. This would enable true nanometer scale 3D printing where the ink is synthetic DNA.
Okay, now another nanobiomaterials, the protein. So protein is mentioned as the machinery of life because protein behave like a machine. So protein are very important molecule to all life. And they are one of four of life basic building block. Sugar, carbohydrate, lipid, or the fat, nucleic acid, DNA, we have already talked about it, and protein. So protein makes up about 50% of your body weight and serve on kind of function. For example here, protein perform structural function. What about structural function? Imagine about your body. Protein, you can move your body, you can have stable body shape because of the protein. The muscle that wrap around your bone, make the form of your body. So it performs structural function. It can perform transport function. That I will show you later about the this function. It can perform storage, to be a storage. It takes, it keep, it store something. It can be the catalyst seed, or enzyme. It has perform antibody, kill invader, invader outside of your body, kill the bacteria, virus. It is a hormone. Hormone is the mechanism to regulate behavior of your body. And to start something at a specific time. This is the type of the function of the hormone. Normally, protein has some type of organizational structure. Protein, when it is synthesized inside your body, it has, at the beginning, it will have very basic structure called the primary structure. Primary structure is one-dimensional structure. So you see the one-dimensional structure means it has a very long chain, yeah, and it does not take specific shape. Yeah. In this case, protein will not function. Yeah. Protein will function only when it form up. Yeah. It form up to make three-dimensional structure. We call this the protein folding. Yeah. So when you have when your body synthesize the protein, it has the shape like this. Yeah. It we call it the primary structure. And it has to form secondary structure. Secondary structure with the secondary structure, it form two dimension. Yeah. From one dimension, but one dimension is called primary structure. When the one dimension start to form two dimension, we call it secondary structure. So the two dimension has, for example, two type, yeah, beta, yeah, beta structure is like a sheath or a plana structure, yeah. Alpha helix is a kind of folding to make a circular folding, yeah. We call alpha helix, yeah. And when alpha helix and beta sheet combined together, it creates three-dimensional structure. This three-dimensional structure we call tertiary structure. Yeah. And with this, the tertiary structure, the protein can function. Yeah. Some type of protein, they have even further more complex structure called quaternary structure. What is the quaternary structure? If you have more than one protein molecule connect or combine or integrate together, we call this the quaternary structure. Normally, most protein, it has up to tertiary structure, except some type of protein. It will not function only at the tertiary structure. It needs more complex structure to be able to do something, yeah, or to be able to work. This quaternary structure, if you look at this one, this is a hemoglobin. Yeah. Here, it comprises of four protein molecules. Yeah. So this quaternary structure, it has four protein that have tertiary structure. Yeah. So from primary to secondary to tertiary, yeah, it has complete protein molecule. Yeah. Only some type of molecule, it need more than tertiary structure. Yeah. It may need more than one protein molecule to combine together, to work together. And to be able to function, yeah, and have quaternary structure. Yeah. So let's see in details for each type of the structure. Yeah. For example, here, the primary structure of protein. Protein in the living things on our earth comprised of around 20 amino acid species. So there are around 20, you can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and this is a four row. So it's 20, yeah, 20 protein, 20 amino acid. Yeah. So every amino acid, if you look at every amino acid, it looks the same, yeah, it looks similar, yeah. It has COOH group, we call the carboxyl group, yeah, it's an amino group, yeah, and it connect to each other. This amino group and carboxyl group, it connect to each other by a carbon. This carbon is called alpha carbon, yeah, and every amino acid has share this same structure. What is the difference? You see, this is 20 amino acids. What is the difference? The difference is only at the side chain. Here, you see here, glycine, alanine. What is the difference? You see, this is a carboxylic acid, yeah, the same. This is the amino group, just the same. What the difference is the side chain here? Glycine has two hydrogen, but alanine has carbonyl group. And if you look at the saline here, you see the difference is this side chain only. Yeah. The side chain makes a difference. Yeah. But the basic thing is amino group and the carboxylic group. This is the same. Yeah. So the side chain define the character of each amino acid. Some amino acid has hydrophobic property, it hates water. Some amino acid has acidic property because it has more acid group. Some amino acid, it has a basic property because it has a base, a basic group like ammonium. Ammonium has a property, has a base property. So, and with this variety, it makes different type of protein. So amino acid combine with each other via peptide bond. You see here, this is when two amino acid react to each other, it release water molecule. So when you eat hmu gatha or Korea barbecue, you can notice that, you can observe that you are thirsty, you want to drink water. Why? Because you see here, when two amino acids combine each other, it creates water. Yeah. So if you eat a protein, you have a lot of peptide bond. Yeah. Your stomach can absorb not the protein, but the amino acid. So when you eat protein, you eat hmu gatha or Korean barbecue, you have to digest, you have to chop the protein down into amino acid level. And in that process, you need water. That's why you are thirsty, you want to drink a lot of water. Yeah. So from the primary structure, then we have secondary structure. And this secondary structure, I already mentioned that there are different types of structure to create two-dimensional structure. Yeah. The beta sheet, beta barrel, the alpha helix. Yeah. And for the tertiary structure, originate from combining, for example, secondary structure together. You see alpha helix combined with beta barrel or beta sheet and create tertiary structure. Yeah. For the quaternary structure, you need more than one protein to bind together. Yeah. So here, this is a summary. Yeah. From single amino acid, create secondary structure, tertiary structure here, and quaternary structure here. Yeah. So I will show video that we make it easy to understand.
Proteins play countless roles throughout the biological world. Some transport nutrients throughout the body. Some help chemical reactions to happen at faster rates. Others build the structures that make up living things. Despite this wide range of functions, all proteins are made out of the same 21 building blocks, called amino acids. Amino acids are made of carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, and hydrogen atoms, and some contain sulfur atoms. Selenocysteine is the only standard amino acid that contains a selenium atom. These atoms form an amino group, a carboxyl group, and a side chain, all attached to a central carbon atom. The side chain determines an amino acid's properties and is the only part that varies from amino acid to amino acid. Hydrophobic amino acids have carbon-rich side chains, which don't interact well with water. Hydrophilic, or polar, amino acids interact well with water. Charged amino acids interact with oppositely charged amino acids or with other molecules. Primary structure. The primary structure of a protein is the linear sequence of amino acids as encoded by DNA. The amino acids in a protein are joined by peptide bonds, which link the amino group of one amino acid to the carboxyl group of another. A water molecule is released each time a peptide bond is formed. This linked series of carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen atoms is the protein backbone. Protein chains often fold into two types of secondary structures, alpha helices and beta sheets. An alpha helix is a right-handed coil stabilized by hydrogen bonds between the amine and carboxyl groups of nearby amino acids. Beta sheets are formed when hydrogen bonds stabilize two or more adjacent strands of amino acids. The tertiary structure of a protein is the three-dimensional shape of the protein chain. This shape is determined by the characteristics of the amino acids making up the chain. Many proteins form globular shapes with hydrophobic side chains sheltered on the inside, away from surrounding water molecules. Membrane-bound proteins have hydrophobic amino acids clustered together on their exteriors, so that hydrophobic side chains can interact with the lipids in the membrane. Charged amino acids allow proteins to interact with molecules that have complementary charges. The functions of many proteins rely upon their three-dimensional shapes. For example, hemoglobin forms a pocket to hold heme, a small molecule with an iron atom in the center that binds to oxygen. Quaternary structure. Two or more polypeptide chains can come together to form one functional molecule with several subunits. The four subunits of hemoglobin...
Most proteins, they end at the tertiary structure, but only some type of protein. For example, hemoglobin, yeah, in this video, yeah, it needs the combination of four hemoglobin protein, yeah, to combine together in order to function.
Cooperate so the complex can more easily pick up oxygen in the lungs and release it in the body. Different visual representations of proteins can give us visual clues about protein structure and function. This space-filling diagram shows all of the atoms that make up this protein. This representation, called a ribbon or cartoon diagram, shows the organization of the protein backbone and highlights alpha helices. This surface representation shows the areas in the protein that are accessible to water molecules. Most proteins are smaller than the wavelength of light. For example, the hemoglobin molecule is about 6.5 nanometers in size. Hemoglobin is found in high concentration in red blood cells. A typical red blood cell contains about 280 million hemoglobin molecules. The three-dimensional shapes of proteins determine their function. The flexible arms of antibodies protect us from disease by recognizing and binding to pathogens and targeting them for destruction by the immune system. The hormone insulin is a small stable protein that can easily maintain its shape while traveling through the blood to regulate blood glucose level. Alpha amylase is an enzyme that begins digestion of starches in our saliva.
This is the protein in our, the protein in our mouth, yeah, to digest carbohydrate. That makes you, when you eat rice, what it makes rice sweet, yeah, because of this protein, yeah, the importance of this protein.
The calcium pump is aided by magnesium and powered by ATP to move calcium ions back to the sarcoplasmic reticulum after each muscle contraction. Ferritin is a spherical protein with channels that allow iron atoms to enter and exit depending upon an organism's needs.
On the inside,
ferritin forms a hollow space with iron atoms attached to the inner wall. Ferritin stores iron in a non-toxic
so that
form.
It can be concentrated. Yeah. Let's see.
Collagen forms a strong triple helix that is used throughout the body for structural support.
Yeah, collagen for your face, your skin, and
collagen molecules can form elongated fibrils, which aggregate to form collagen fibers. This type of collagen is abundant in skin and tendons. Learn more about the functions and 3D structures of proteins and other molecular.
So I think when we talk about when we talk about protein, one type of function that people like to think about is the muscle. And here, if you look in this slide, you will see that the protein that build a muscle has a very complicated structure. For example, if you look at your muscle on your shoulder, you will see that in the muscle, from the muscle, it will have a bundle of fiber. And when we zoom, we will see that it has hierarchy. Until it's bottom to single protein cell. And with this single protein cell here, we will have a kind of protein molecule called actin and myosin. And this type of molecule make a muscle contraction. When you pull something, when you lift something, when you move your leg, your hand, or your arm, it needs this muscle contraction. And in this muscle contraction, it has a very complex machinery work. So this molecule is like a machine. It has a hook, you see, this molecule has a lot of hook. This hook will make its clamp. Can make its clamp on the fiber that makes that allow the muscle cell to contract. So the concept of muscle work is by contraction and release of the contraction. So sometimes when you have problem with your muscle, you cannot move. If you cannot move your muscle or you have pain at your muscle, that's because your muscle contract, but it does not release. That's why you need massage. So people, they go to massage. Why? Because they want to relax the muscle cell, the muscle body. And the muscle contraction, it has the theory that explains how it works. It's called the sliding theory. Here, this is a myosin molecule. The myosin molecule has hooker. And this hooker will try to hook the actin so that later you see the actin come close together. This is the contract This is the contraction of the muscle cell. Yeah. The hook here will clamp on the actin. Yeah. And I will show you the video and you will understand more clearly. Yeah. And we call this the sliding theory. Yeah. If all you see in the muscle, there are a lot of actin and myosin path. Yeah. There are a lot here along the line. Yeah. If every actin and myosin contract on together, it will have a lot of power. Yeah. Single cell is very small. Yeah. But when the muscle work, it work on together. Yeah. When it work on together, the contraction will make a lot of power here. Yeah. Show you the video. Oh, this video.
Sliding filament theory is the mechanism by which muscles are thought to contract at a cellular level. An understanding of the structure of skeletal muscle is useful when learning how sliding filament theory works. Each muscle is made up of a number of bundles of muscle fibers. Each bundle of muscle fibers contains anywhere from 10 and 100 individual fibers. Each muscle fiber itself contains cylindrical organelles known as myofibrils, which themselves are bundles of proteins called actin and myosin. Surrounding the myofibril, there is a network of tubules and channels called the sarcoplasmic reticulum, where calcium is stored. Each myofibril can be broken down into functional repeating segments called sarcomeres. If we look at a two-dimensional model of a sarcomere, it consists of actin and myosin. When a nerve impulse arrives at the muscle, it causes a release of a chemical called acetylcholine. The presence of acetylcholine causes depolarization, enabling calcium to be released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. The calcium binds to troponin, changing its shape, and so moving tropomyosin from the active site of the actin. The myosin filaments can now attach to the actin, forming a cross bridge. The breakdown of ATP releases energy, which enables the myosin to pull the actin filaments inwards, contracting the muscle. This occurs along the entire length of every myofibril in the muscle cell. When an ATP molecule binds to the myosin head, the myosin detaches from the actin and the cross bridge is broken. When the ATP is then broken down, the myosin head can again attach to an actin binding site further along the actin filament and repeat the process. This repeated pulling of the actin over the myosin is often known as the ratchet mechanism. This process of muscular contraction can last for as long as there are adequate ATP and Ca plus stores. Once the nerve impulse stops, the Ca plus is pumped back to the sarcoplasmic reticulum and the actin returns to its resting position, causing the muscle to lengthen and relax.
You see that the muscle, when it works, it contracts. And if you want to work again with the muscle, you have to release it, otherwise it cannot contract, it cannot compress anymore. Yeah. So if you search, you can search by yourself, the muscle, actin and myosin, sliding filament theory. Yeah. If you just search sliding filament theory, there are a lot of video. Yeah.
Hey, what's up guys, Matt with the Movement System. Yeah.
Okay, another, the next biomaterial that I would like to mention is the biomembrane. Yeah. The importance of the biomembrane is that it encloses the cell. Yeah. It encloses, it is the border of the cell. It encloses many organelles together, not only the cell, but inside you see, this is the cell and some organelle here like centriole, it also has a biomembrane or nucleus here. Yeah. The nucleus here the separation between nucleus and the liquid inside the cell is separated by biomembrane. Yeah. And mitochondria or other organelle in the cell, it needs the biomembrane. So biomembrane is very important because it makes things, it separates things, it separates inside from the outside, and it keep the environment, it keep the environment inside the thing that it enclosed, to make this stable, to keep stability of the cell and whatever it enclosed. Okay, now we should have a look at how it works. The biomembrane is a selective permeable membrane, so it allows something to pass and does not allow many things to pass, so it's selective membrane. And for the biomembrane, it may have protein, carbohydrate, or embedded into it. But the structure, the structure is simple. It has lipid, and the lipid has two components: the head and the tail. The head is the polar or hydrophilic. The tail is hydrophobic. Hydrophilic means love water. Hydrophobic means hate water. So if you have such kind of molecule, then it will form bilayer, because normally in the cell there are plenty of water. So it will dilate. It will dilate the head, it will dilate the head to the cell, to the external environment, and keep the tail inside so that the tail will not touch water. This is a style of biomembrane. I will show a video later. So here for the biomembrane, you can design different type of the head. So there are plenty type of the head like this. Phosphatidylethanolamine, PE, okay, you can have PS or phosphatidylserine, PC or phosphatidylcholine. You can design different type of the head to make it more hydrophilic or less hydrophilic. You can make together. Just a moment, I have some urgent SIM calling. Just a moment. So because of the selective permeability of biomembrane, you see that for small molecule, it can pass freely. But for chart, for chart particle like ion, yeah, it cannot pass. Yeah. For large molecule amino acid glucose nucleotide, it cannot pass. Yeah. So it needs some type of protein channel, yeah, or transport protein that can allow that can select something to pass through. Yeah. This is the kind of the transport across the biomembrane. Yeah. So simple molecule like oxygen, it can pass. Yeah. Passive transport means if you have higher concentration here, it can pass through. Yeah. But active transport means if here, this is the high concentration, it's had, for example, here you see green cube, here there are three, but here there is only one. So here it has higher concentration. Yeah. So it's impossible that this green one will go out because here this is high pressure. Yeah. So in order to put less concentrated particle outside, yeah, to a higher concentration environment, you need to pump it. Yeah. So it needs energy. Yeah. So in our cell, we have this type of transport. Yeah. So what is the application of bilayer? Yeah. Nowadays we have a lot of application already in the market. If you buy cosmetic, you will see sometimes it will say that it made of the liposome. Yeah. If you buy some cosmetic, some cream to make your face look young, yeah, in the market, you will be assumed, yeah, to use liposome technology. Yeah. Here, this is how to make the liposome. Yeah. Normally, the liposome is made of lipid bilayer. You see the lipid bilayer, as I explained before, that it, because the lipid comprised of the hydrophilic head and hydrophobic tail, it is not stable in water. So the tail will try to dilate or stay with each other, and it will expose the hydrophilic head, yeah, or the polar part outside, yeah, to water. Yeah. So in this case, you see the head is the red, yeah, and the tail is the white one. Yeah. So this makes the bilayer more stable, yeah, because the polar direction, yeah, the polar head already touched the water, yeah, and the tail keep inside. But you see at the edge is still not favorable, yeah, because water still can approach to this hydrophobic part. Yeah. So in order to escape from water molecule, how they do it? Yeah. The bilayer will seal itself. Yeah. Because spontaneous sealing, it will seal itself so that the hydrophobic part will be enclosed. Yeah. And no water molecule can access or approach this unstable part. Yeah. So here you have a liposome, yeah, enclosed one. And the liposome has a cavity. Yeah. You can put, for example, the drug, you can put nutrient, you can put DNA, you can put whatever you want to deliver to your body. Yeah. Because the liposome is biocompatible. Yeah. When you put liposome on your skin, it will be absorbed easier inside your skin. Yeah. Because liposome is biocompatible, your immunity will not reject it. Yeah. So it is easier when you use liposome. Normally the cosmetic company will inject some cosmetic inside the liposome, and it will be easier to deliver into your body. Yeah, this is a different type of my Basom technology. Yeah. I would like you to follow in consecutive step. Yeah. First, you just look at the top left. Yeah. A here. Yeah. This is a conventional ribosome. Just look at this. Yeah. You will see that the ribosome comprised of the bilayer here. And conventional ribosome is simple. Yeah. You just put hydrophobic drug here. You can do it because the tail here is hydrophobic. Yeah. You can put anything inside the cavity, yeah, so that it can be delivered inside your body. Okay, just a moment. And for the function, for the higher or more complex structure, please have a look at the B. Yeah. In this structure, then you put polyethylene glycol, yeah, onto the head part of the lipid molecule, yeah, to make it more stable. Yeah. So we call it the pegylated liposome, yeah, to make it more stable, yeah, because if you have conventional liposome, maybe it not stable enough, maybe when it touch your skin, maybe it broken, yeah, immediately, yeah. So when you put this polyethylene glycol, you make the liposome more rigid, yeah. And for the C, yeah, it's more complex, yeah. You see that not only PEG, yeah, you can put other molecule, you can put other or different type of molecular component, yeah, so that your liposome will be smarter, will be more intelligent. For example here, if you put antibody here, then your liposome will be able to detect virus, yeah, or to detect bacteria and can deliver the drug here to the virus. Yeah. You can put carbohydrate, yeah, you can put protein or peptide, yeah, in order to make it different function. Yeah. And if you look into number D, for the number D is like number C, yeah, but this liposome has more function. Yeah. It, for example, you can put the imaging agent so that this liposome can be the sensor and can be the drug to heal your to heal your cell all together. Yeah. So it means one liposome can do more than one function. Yeah. So number D is the multifunctional liposome. Okay, we have mentioned protein, lipid, and DNA. Yeah, and the last part of my lecture, I would like to talk about the polysaccharide, yeah, or the carbohydrate. Yeah. Okay. Before going on.
Traditional supplements like tablets, capsules, powders, and even some nutrients from your diet are not processed and absorbed efficiently by your body and are passed as waste, never making it into your cells where they're needed most. Livon Labs' patented lipospheric delivery system maximizes the absorption of nutrients by using liposomes. Liposomes are microscopic liquid-filled spheres made from essential phospholipids. This structure not only protects the active nutrient from destruction in the digestive system, but also allows liposomes to seamlessly deliver nutrients to cells in the body. Within minutes of ingesting lipospheric supplements, our nutrient-filled liposomes enter the bloodstream intact and release their active nutrients directly to the cells. Livon Labs lipospheric encapsulation technology is the most efficient way to deliver nutrients orally, outperforming all other forms of supplements. The difference is in the delivery. Take your vitamins and nutrients the lipospheric way.
Like protein, yeah. You see, lipid is different, yeah. It's differently, yeah, because the lipid molecule is not polymer, yeah. But the polysaccharide, the carbohydrate, and protein has similarity because it is a polymer, yeah. And in the protein, it has a peptide bond, but in polysaccharide, it connect each sugar together via the glycosidic bond, yeah. And with this glycosidic bond, when you break the bond, you need to put water, yeah, the same. Yeah. When the two sugar molecules combine together to make the polymer, it releases water molecule. So this is the similarity between the polysaccharide and the polypeptide. Yeah. So here in the world, this is the sugar, yeah, most commonly, yeah, in the world, yeah. But for us, maybe we will know maybe only for example glucose or galactose, yeah. This is what you have heard more often, yeah. But actually in the world there are quite many sugar, yeah, molecule, yeah. And cellulose is the most common, yeah, known polysaccharide, yeah, in the world. Yeah. 33% of the plant matter are cellulose. So it is the most found compound on earth. Yeah. The most found organic compound, not only compound, but organic compound on earth. This is the cellulose. Yeah. So if you know how to use cellulose, you will be rich, yeah, because in the environment allow you find cellulose everywhere, yeah. So if you have technology to use cellulose, you will be very rich, yeah. You can make a lot of business from cellulose, yeah. And here the cellulose has also have a complicated structure like the muscle, yeah. I will show you the video how plant do photosynthesis, make sugar, and then transform sugar into the cellulose to make the leaf, to make the stem, yeah, to make the structure of the plant. Yeah. This is quite amazing, yeah, and complicated. Yeah. And later I will show you the video. And that's why a lot of scientists around the world, they are working on nanocellulose. Yeah. They make nanocellulose to make the paint, make the paper, make textile, even the solar cell, and even LED. Yeah, it has electronic property. Yeah, some derivative of the cellulose, you can make the LED, yeah, from paper. Yeah, you can make sensor, and I think some of you lady or girls in our class, you use the face mask, yeah, to make your face look young, yeah. Maybe you do it at night, yeah. Use face mask on your face, yeah. This also have a nanocellulose in it, yeah. And in the video I will show you that they even invent body of the car from nanocellulose, yeah. Because of the transparency property of the nanocellulose, yeah, you can make a plastic. You can do 3D printing of cellulose into as a part or component maybe of the car or of some electric appliance, because it transparent. Some plastic, when you make a 3D printer, when you have a 3D printing, it does not allow the light to pass. But for the cellulose, it's transparent. So many people use nanocellulose to make such a part. So here, I will show you the video that how the plant cell is made of the cellulose. So here, this is 1 nanometer. Yeah, you see, it's a nanoscale.
The most abundant polymer on Earth made by living things is cellulose. The cellulose molecule is a long, flat ribbon made of thousands of glucose subunits linked together into chains. Plants produce cellulose using enzymes to drive the catalytic synthesis reaction. Enzymes are grouped together into symmetrical rings on the outer membrane of plant cells. As the cellulose is generated, it passes through the enzyme from inside the plant cell to outside of the membrane surface. The emerging cellulose molecules are spun together to form strong, flexible fibers. The cellulose fibers are laid down layer upon layer to build up a thick outer cell wall. An outer coat of cellulose gives plant cells strength and protection, enabling them to form and hold different shapes. Cellulose makes timber strong for building homes, or can be woven into the soft fabric of a cotton shirt. It has been used to make paper for thousands of years, with industrial uses including explosives and plastics.
Another video to show how they make cellulose a body of the car by Japanese company. And for the carbohydrate, yeah, not only cellulose that is available, yeah, we have different type of carbohydrate molecule, yeah, called chitin and chitosan. You may have heard about it already. Yeah, yeah, you see that for cellulose, the attachment to the ring normally is hydroxyl, yeah, hydroxyl group. Yeah, yeah, if we have a look, you see only hydroxyl group here. Yeah, this is cellulose. Yeah. But for chitin and chitosan, yeah, the hydroxyl here sometimes is changed to this group, yeah, NSCOCS3. Yeah, we call this chitin. Yeah, you see the OH group should have three, yeah, but one of them, yeah, is replaced by chitin group. Yeah, and here one of the hydroxyl groups replaced by amine group, yeah, NH2. Yeah. So the property also change. Yeah. Mostly the cellulose, yeah, the plant select this type of structure to be the plant select cellulose, yeah, to make its structure. Yeah. But chitin and chitosan, the animal, yeah, select chitin and chitosan to be its structure. For example, crabs, yeah, insect, lobster and beetle, yeah, they select chitin and chitosan, not cellulose. Yeah. So chitin is the derivative of glucose, yeah, and it is the main component of the fungi, the cell of fungi, the exoskeleton of an arthropod. Yeah. Arthropod, crabs, lobster, shrimp, yeah, and insect. Yeah. Ants, beetle, butterflies. So here, yeah, the chitin and chitosan also have a complex structure like cellulose. Yeah. If you look in here, how to synthesize, how to create the same one of plants, very complicated. Yeah. The same. If you want to create the exoskeleton, the skin, yeah, of lobster is also have hierarchy, yeah, also complicated. Yeah. So chitin and chitosan has many applications. Yeah. For example, here, yeah, you can use it as a filter, yeah, to capture the methane ions for wastewater. You use it for paper coating. Yeah. You use it as an artificial layer. Yeah. And in agriculture, they use chitosan a lot. Yeah, for making plant medium. Yeah. And in medicine, yeah, they use the chitosan, yeah, for example, for bone regeneration, treatment of rheumatoid disease. Yeah. They use it as an artificial skin, yeah, the same as cellulose. Yeah. You see, artificial skin to repair the skin of the burn wounded, yeah, and also in pharmaceutical. So chitin and chitosan, you see, have a lot of application. Cosmetic, yeah, they also have a chitosan in moisturizer, yeah, hair shampoo, hair styling. Okay, they use in agriculture, plant growth regulator, yeah, to accelerate the growth of the plant. Yeah. So now, I already finished the lecture. Yeah. So thank you very much for your attention. Yeah. So if some of you missed some class you can go to see in YouTube. Yeah, it's the code in my channel. Yeah. So, any question from you or something to discuss, you can open your microphone and you can discuss with me. Yeah. Otherwise, we will leave the class. Yeah. So I don't know how about the examination, but I guess Ajahn Da Kong will collect the question from different parts and provide you maybe the exam paper. Yeah. So for my class, if you look at the slide, I may have question in the exam. For example, I may ask you to give example of the nano material that you know most. And I ask you to explain what is the nano material that you want to talk about, you want to discuss, and you give example of this nano material. And you may explain about the structure of this nanomaterial. Yeah. For example, if you know about conductive polymer, you may give example of conductive polymer. What is the application of it? If you know about protein, yeah, you explain about its structure, about its application. If you know carbon nanotube very well, you can give example of carbon nanotube and explain the application of this carbon nanotube. Yeah. And also maybe business idea. What will you do to make it commercialized or to make money from it? For example, I will have such a question like this. Yeah. Not difficult. Yeah. So don't worry about this part. Yeah. Okay, nobody like to talk, yeah. Okay, thank you very much, and I wish you all the best, yeah, and be happy in your study at Maidon University. Thank you. Bye bye.
Ajahn Khab.
はじめまして大好きな音楽へずっと考えてたことどうか聞いてほしくって伝えたい言葉ちょっと照れくさいけれどずっと思っていたことこんなお手紙に込めてどんな時もあなたの言葉声を聞いているだけで力が湧いてくるんだ辛いくらい痛い日もあるけどね、あなたに触れる。